As many of you know, November 30th was Andrew's sixth heaven day. I shared our adventure on social media. If you guys don't follow me, I do post about once a week with the podcast title, along with the description and easy links in my story. You can find me at Grief Mentor. It's not the Grief Mentor, that was already taken. So you can find me there on Facebook at Grief Mentor and on Instagram. I do have a YouTube channel, mainly just for people that are not able to access the podcast any other way. It's Teresa Davis, the Grief Mentor, and I post the episodes there only. I really don't have much time to do much else there. I created that channel just for the podcast. And by the way, I'm trialing something new this week. I will be releasing a new episode on Saturday a.m. Now, I'm not committing to two episodes a week, but I am trialing that this week to see how it goes. I'm attempting to establish if there is a need and if you will have time and or the desire to listen to me twice a week. I'll let you know how it goes. So in today's episode, we are sharing with you how we managed Andrew's heaven day this year. So if you need ideas on what to do to honor your child on their heaven day or special days like birthdays, stay tuned and we're going to walk you through each step of our day.
Are you lost in the chaos of grief, struggling to find your way in the darkness? Are you asking yourself, will I ever be able to enjoy life again? Are you wondering where God is right now? Welcome to the Grief Mentor Show. This podcast is a safe place for you. It will shine a light into the shadows, helping you discover that joy and pain can coexist, that you still have purpose, and there is a path to peace. Hello, friend. I'm Teresa Davis. I, too, was lost in the chaos of grief the day my son died. Just like you, I longed for peace in this unfamiliar world. I longed for the weight crushing my chest to be lifted so I could breathe. I clung tightly to the anchor, and it was there that I discovered the tools I needed to navigate life after loss. And I'm ready to help you do the same. If you're ready, I'm holding my hand out to you, friend. Let me show you the way, one step at a time.
Friends, the Black Friday sale is over, and I do have new students enrolled in the January class, but there is still room for you. The waitlist is back up on my website, and I highly encourage you to join the waitlist if you're interested at all in joining us. And I have something special planned coming around the 1st of January, so stay tuned. You don't want to miss that. In the meantime, let's sit down together and work through what you need to process your grief. Because, friend, living in your own headspace and trying to manage your grief alone will not go well for you. Slivers of hope. That's what you need. After I meet with my clients, I send out detailed post-session notes. Now, the reason I do that is because I've been where you are, and I remember what it's like to try to remember something that I heard that was beneficial to me, and I know how difficult that is to do when you're in the throes, especially of early grief. I remember rushing out to my car and grabbing my notebook and pen that I'd laid in my car seat and just frantically trying to write down every word that I could remember from our time together. Friend, you do not have to do that because I do it for you. And I will tell you, today, every one of my clients tell me how thankful they are for those post-session notes. It makes a big difference for you to be able to process the information more than once. You not only hear it, then you're able to read it, and then it allows that information to be absorbed by more than one sense. Plus, it gives you notes to refer back to. So visit my website today at thegriefmentor.com and book your call. Today, I have a special guest with me, and it is my husband, Andrew's dad. Welcome, Tony.
Hey, thank you.
Tony is not new to the podcast. You have heard from him before. I believe this is like our third time.
Yes, I think it's our third.
Third time to share our grief on Andrew's heaven day. We honored Andrew this year, this past Saturday. If you guys, as I said, saw my stories, you watched our day unfold. Andrew loved Krispy Kreme donuts. In fact, if the light was on, he was there. So for those of you that struggle with what to do to honor your child, we're going to give you a glimpse into our day, how we came up with our plan, how we planned it, how we executed it, and then we'll just share with you how that affected our ability to be able to honor Andrew well. We planned this ahead of time. Tony was kind of in charge of that, right?
Yeah.
So you printed some labels.
Printed some labels that had a picture of our fireplace hearth on our screened-in porch last year. We decorated it, and I put that on the label, and then I put in memory of Andrew Davis, and then we called it Krispy Kreme Donut Day.
That's exactly right. And then we ordered the donuts ahead of time because last year, remember when we got there?
We showed up, caught them off guard.
Yeah, we kind of bought all the donuts in the store. So she said, next year, give us a heads up. So we did.
And that's what we did.
When we arrived there, though, they were having some technical difficulties.
Yeah, their system was down to where they could only do cash only. They weren't even able to look up and see what kind of discount they could maybe offer us.
Yeah, so we bought a lot of donuts, no discount, but the little gal behind the desk, as precious as she was, she gave us free donuts again. She gave us free donuts last year, bless her heart. We shared our story with her, and we showed her the picture of Andrew because we have a picture of him sitting in front of a box of donuts, and he's sitting there with Jack. Erica, his wife, took the picture, and they have on the Krispy Kreme donut hats, and Andrew's got this cute look on his face,
got
like,
a
wow.
Smile from ear to ear. So, he loved his donuts.
He did. But the doors were locked when we got there, so we didn't know what was going to happen. And we got there early because we had planned how many donuts we needed, right? If you're thinking about doing something like this for your child, if this sounds overwhelming to you, we didn't do this in the beginning.
No,
right?
This is our second year we've
done. This is only our second year. So we did it last year. Would have been his fifth heaven day. Don't feel a lot of pressure that you have to do something this elaborate. We have kind of evolved to this over time.
Yeah.
And it kind of combines, for those of you that have taken the course, the Grief Roadmap, you know, we talk a lot about how to manage those special days. And I give you lots of ideas, but I also encourage you to not take on more than you can handle, because it that will just make the grief that much worse. So it's taken us a while to get here.
And you don't want to wait to the last minute neither, because then you're overwhelmed for sure.
Yeah. So we got our donuts and we took our picture. We always take a picture every year of all the staff, and also had a little picture of Andrew there in the window too, of him and with the donuts there in the store. And it was so precious because we always take a picture of the light on outside of Krispy Kreme, because that was Andrew's thing, right? You want to share that memory of you guys?
We were working the week before he passed, and we was working on the furnace, and we'd went to the Menard hardware store next to Krispy Kreme Donuts. And on our way back, we're coming home, and he makes a real sudden jerk, and I thought we was getting ready to hit a car or something. And I'm like, what's going on? He said, the light's on. And we had to go get donuts while Teresa was sitting at the house with no furnace, and it was probably about 30-some degrees outside.
Yeah. Yeah, so when they came in, they came packing these donuts, and so I was like, oh, okay, I know where you've been. But so it's important for us to get a picture with the light on, because that's a good memory for Tony with him and Andrew. But because they were having technical difficulties, they didn't have the light on, guys, because they had, when we got there, there was a sign on the door that said they were closed. So we could see our order. We could see the big stack of donuts sitting on the end of the counter. So we called them, and of course they let us in. But what she did for us was so special, because we were outside and she could see us trying to get the sign in the background to get a picture, kind of, you know, a selfie kind of thing with us in there too. And we realized the light wasn't on. We kind of just said, oh, well, we went to walk away. And as we were walking away, she turned that light on just for us. It was so special for her
Very
to do
special.
That. Yeah. If you are planning, if you're having a special day coming up, the planning part of it is really the hardest part of it. And like I said, we did this last year, and we learned some things last year when we did it that we put in place this year. But this is kind of an act of service. Those of you that have been in my one-on-one sessions and in the Grief Roadmap, we talk about different ways to honor our children. And one of those is acts of service. So this is a combination for us. We're taking one of Andrew's memories, something that he loved that was special to him, and then we combine that with an act of service, because now we're taking donuts, and we had a list of people that meant something to us.
We make a list. Yeah. The airport's usually one of them on that list, because he's still got the flight instructor that instructed Andrew when he first took his flight lessons. in high school, still instructs, and we always make sure we get him a dozen donuts.
We have several people that we take donuts to, and it's not the same every time. This year we took some to some different folks than we did last year. Heck. But it's a way, it's a fun way, because who doesn't smile, right, when you're giving them
getting a donut?
A donut. Yeah. And it's also the gravity of it. You can see people. They'll smile and they'll say thank you, and then the gravity of it hits them, but it allows them to share in our grief with us.
Yeah, and I had one of our workers in middle school ministry last night at church ask me, is there such thing as a Krispy Kreme donut day? Because she'd seen the posting on our social media site. And I just said, no, we just call it Krispy Kreme donut day because that was a day that we like to remember Andrew and because he loved donuts.
Yeah, it's kind of like our special day on the calendar. And it also, it allowed us to talk about Andrew all day. And we got to revisit memories with people that mean something to us. And it just is a really good, feel-good day for us to be able to do that. Now, it was exhausting.
It was exhausting, but just to see the smiles that we brought.
Yeah.
You know, that was that brought a lot of joy.
And then we came home and rested for a bit. And then his heaven day is close to Christmas. We always meet at the airport, and Erica always brings a Christmas tree. And this year, Sarah brought hot chocolate.
Mm-hmm.
And we sang Christmas carols.
Yep. Decorate the little tree the grandkids did. And then we always hang some Christmas decoration on the shepherd hooks that we had the lanterns on, and just kind of decorate it for Christmas. And it's just something we do as a family. It's just another way of remembering Andrew. We talk about different things sometimes while we're up there doing that.
And it's a great way to keep his memory alive. And if you have littles like we do in our life, it's a way for them to be able to talk about their dad in heaven. For us to be able to come together as a family is very comforting for them. And I don't know about you, Tony, this year, I think for the first time, it felt a little more like a celebration than it has in the years past.
Yeah, I mean, it wasn't as heavy as last year as it had been in the past, but this year did seem more relaxing, more celebratory.
Celebratory, yeah. I would agree.
And yeah, especially with the grands, because now we got five of them that are old enough to help decorate the Christmas tree that Eric and Alex always brings. Mm-hmm. So it was kind of neat watching them, because they were so excited to get to do that. And that's just their way of remembering Andrew.
Mm-hmm. We're fortunate because where Andrew's memorial is, we don't have some restrictions like others might have in cemeteries. They pretty much let us do what we want there. We had two shepherd hooks that sit next to his memorial, and we keep lanterns on those, because to us, it's like Andrew's life and his witness is leading the way for others toward Christ. Because one of the songs that was we had at his memorial is Jesus is my legacy. And that's why we have those lighted lanterns there. They're solar, because we do feel like that Andrew's legacy is lighting the way to others toward Christ.
Still shining.
We live in a small community here in a little kind of a cozy little Midwestern town. And because the accident was very public, I've shared a lot of that already on the podcast. But so many have not only grieved with us, but have watched our grief. And that can be a blessing and a curse, right?
Mm-hmm.
Knowing that people are watching your grief. But because of our devotion and our faith, and we have become stronger in our faith, and we've had some rough times, and you guys know that. But because of that, one step at a time, we feel like that light is leading the way. And then Tony had the idea this year about the hats.
Yeah. I don't know what it just, I thought, I'm going to get some Krispy Kreme hats, and we're going to have all the grandkids, we got six of them, wear the hats with donuts in hand and get a picture of them in a group picture. And that's on the site, social media sites.
Yeah.
So you'll be able to see that.
Well, it's down now. It's just stories.
Just stories.
I might make a reel. Yeah. I have several. If I have some time, I might make a reel.
I thought maybe you had posted them actually on the website or the Facebook site itself.
But several people have asked, so I might turn that into a reel later. But then we went to Erica's house for dinner, Eric and Al's house, and we had Bip and Bap, which so many people say to me, what's Bip and Bap? Which I had no clue what that was until Andrew He was a very good cook, and Tony and I bought them a wok 1 year for Christmas, and it just sent him on a journey, and he started making all kinds of different dishes. And this is a Korean dish. It's basically rice, and you can get it with chicken, pork, or
vegetables.
Steak, and it's vegetables, and it has a fried egg, you know, like a gooey fried egg, like where the yolk is like dripping down through it. So we go to her house, we have bibimbap, and then this year we also watched the memorial video.
Yeah. Watch that. And then we also had the donuts. We took some Christmas donuts. They're calling them Grinchmas. They're like Grinch stuff. And then a regular box of glazed donuts. So we all could have some donuts too.
Yeah. And the memorial video, I remember the first time we did that was last year. Remember that?
Mm-hmm.
And we had not seen that video since Andrew's memorial. So it was pretty, I don't know about you.
It was heavy.
But it was pretty emotional last year.
Heavy.
And I really had a hard time. I didn't want to, obviously, losing control in front of the children. But it was really difficult last year to watch. This year was a little different for me.
Mm-hmm.
I felt like it was a good time of remembering, because the younger children were asking questions. Andrew's oldest two, Jack is 9, Sophia is 7. Jack does have some memories of his dad. Sophia, not so much. I mean, she was 21 months old. But when she sees the pictures of her and her dad, you know, it brings her joy. She doesn't really remember those. But
she gets excited.
Yeah, but it's a way. And even Sarah, our daughter, her daughter is 10 now. So she was the oldest. So she probably has the most memories about that time. But it was so cute because Sadie, the 6-year-old, Andrew, she was born just a few weeks before Andrew's death. And so we have a picture of him holding her. And she always wants to know when her picture's coming up, because all the other kids are all in the videos of the family videos, or the pictures. She always wants to know. And then there's always that picture of Andrew holding her, and he's kind of holding her up and looking at her very affectionately and lovingly. And she always says, "That's me, that's me." So it was just a good way for us to remember. We reminisced. We talked about the pictures this year, and it was kind of a comfort more this year than it has been. Yeah. And we had some snow. So as we were leaving Alan Erica's house, it began to snow, which was kind of a sweet. It was sweet.
Kind of neat.
Yeah.
Kind of neat, because Andrew liked snow.
Andrew
a lot like
snow.
Me.
Yeah, really love the snow. So I wanted to give you a glimpse into how that day went. And the reason it's so important to have a plan, friends, is because we knew when our feet hit the floor Saturday morning exactly what we were going to do. We didn't have that period and angst of, what am I going to do? You don't want that rush of emotion and that heavy, heavy grief to start settling down on you. And we just kind of stayed in motion the whole day.
Yeah, because you want to be able to enjoy that day, the remembrance that you're creating.
Yeah.
Because if you're trying to create something that day, then you're too busy focusing on creating versus remembering.
On the stress of leading up to it, I think, in my opinion, and even now, I remember sitting right here in this chair, looking out the window, as the leaves started to turn and that heaviness started to weigh in on me. And I really had to spend some time with the Lord and focus on what I teach you guys to focus on, right? The things that we can control, the things that God has given us in our dominion to be able to control, because that's really our only choice. And I know you guys have heard me say that many times, but as I've told you, I am one of you. So I do exactly what I teach you. And then when the calendar rolled over to November, I felt that heaviness and that angst again. But Tony and I had this plan in place, and we kind of fine-tuned it as the day got closer. And there was tears. I mean, some of the people we visited, someone who had really just recently met Andrew before his death. They had went on a mission trip with Tony and Andrew, and they had become friends. And her husband just passed away 3 months ago. So we were able to bring some joy into her life by bringing our memory of Andrew and the memory of her husband. So it really is an act of service in a way, because we were serving her in that moment. And you guys know we need each other. We cannot do this grief journey by ourselves here on this earth. We do need each other. Yeah. Anything else you want to share about how we celebrated Andrew's Heaven Day?
No, and I want them to realize there's no right way or wrong way. If something didn't work this year, you can make adjustments or even change plans completely next year. It's not like it's set in stone. Be very flexible with it. Even during the day when you're doing it, allow that flexibility, because it's not something that's that rigid that you have to stay focused on the exact thing.
But I also want to emphasize that this was year six for us. If you're in year one, it's pure survival, and that is completely understandable. You are trying to just literally get through the day. I just would recommend that you don't spend it alone, right? Because when we isolate, it brings even heavier grief and can set us up for situations that probably are not healthy for us, not only mentally, our whole well-being. If this is your first year, come see me. Let's talk about it, because I have lots of ideas, ways that I can encourage you and support you, things that you haven't even thought about. And especially if it's this time of year, because of the heaviness of the holidays, it's a lot. And I will say, our first few years, we just felt suffocated by it, really, because...
And it's important to have some kind of plan, whether you're doing something in remembrance of your child, or if just something you're doing just to help you navigate that day.
Tony, I have three questions that I kind of want to focus on here to wrap our time up together. I'd like for you to share with the folks what has been the biggest struggle in your grief journey and how you overcame it.
Well, I think the biggest struggle I had in the whole thing was that we really had no closure. That was hard. We knew Andrew had died and went to heaven, but we had no physical evidence, earthly evidence. And through counseling, I had a counselor that really helped me greatly in this area. He did some EMT. Is that what they call it? The therapy? What's that one therapy with the light bar?
EMDR?
EMDR. I don't know why I called it EMT. Yeah. Apologize for that. But we did that. And then he had me sit and he says, I want you to visualize a table with everybody around the table, but there's an empty chair for Andrew. And I did that with my eyes closed. And he said, I want you to visualize Andrew walking up to that table and he's smiling. And I did that. And then a moment later, he said, now, Jesus walks up and he puts his arm around Andrew and he's smiling. And I did that. And then he said, now Jesus and Andrew turn around and walked away. And when I did that session, that gave me closure that I had never experienced. And that was a great help. A great help. It's very important that we seek that kind of help. These guys and men and women that do therapy, that's what God's given them this gift for. So it's important to seek that kind of help.
And my long-term listeners know, I've shared with you guys, that I had EMDR by two different counselors. And I think in Tony and I's situation, and many of yours, the trauma of just facing your child's death, it is traumatic. It just is. Each child loss is unique. And when you factor in the way your child dies, you know, in our situation, it was extremely destructive and traumatic and sudden, and then we didn't have any evidence, like Tony said. So it was a huge struggle. That was probably one of my biggest struggles as well. And I've taught you about the different grieving styles, and the difference between Tony and I is that he's a doer. So he is an instrumental griever. He does things to work out his grief physically, whereas I'm more of an intuitive griever. I'm more of a crier. I hold it close, and I'm very careful of who I share my grief with, because our grief is sacred, and I want to make sure whoever I share my grief with is going to respect it, or I'm not going to share it. His go-to is taking care of the memorial. However, that's a very difficult thing for me, because that's really the only evidence that I've ever had that Andrew's no longer here. And it is just a memorial stone. There's no body or anything there. But it's still very hard for me to go there, because that's a concrete visual that Andrew no longer walks this earth. But for Tony, it provides something for him to care for. And that's important.
Yeah. Very therapeutic for me.
Yeah. Well, let's talk about from a dad perspective, mm-hmm. what has been the greatest asset for you to learn to live in the tension of child loss? Now, by that I mean the long haul.
Mm-hmm. I think what helps me is the serving part, is come along to others, especially in their earlier stages of grief, and just walk alongside of them and love on them. Not to maybe even say nothing, just to be there, be an ear. That helps me because in the beginning we needed that real bad. And until I got some help with therapists and learned with the tools that I was equipped with how to navigate, it's kind of like repurposing the pain. You're walking into the life of somebody else that's going through something just tragedy as can be, the loss of a child, because that's not the order it should be. And by doing that, that helps me because that gives me something to look forward to on this journey, is to be able to come alongside other people in the same situation. Mm-hmm. And it's so rewarding. I know when we do While We're Waiting, it's an organization that's a bereaved parent retreat.
They know all about it. I talk about it all the time.
Cool. Wonderful ministry. And you see the people coming in there with looks on their face like, I don't want to be here. Why'd I come? It's a very faith-based. They do hear the gospel on Sunday before we finish. And we just get to come along and love people in a safe place. We get to hear about their children. It's so exciting to hear about the things they did and the life they lived, and just to be a part of that. Mm-hmm. And
It's not just about how they died. It's about how they lived.
It's about how they lived, mm-hmm. It's so rewarding. And that helps me. That gives me that drive, that goal to continue forward on this journey that we've been called on.
I want to be transparent because you guys are listening to Tony and I, and you can probably hear some unity. But it hasn't always been that way. Now, Tony and I have been married a long time, 42 years, but we had some rough times. Mm-hmm. His death brought a lot of stress into our marriage. And because we were both grieving separately, when you live in the same house, you grieve together as far as you're in the same building. But that doesn't mean you're grieving together. I have talked a little bit about marriage and grief. There is a false statistic out there, by the way, that a high percentage of marriage ends in divorce after child loss, and that's really been proven false. But the need for communication cannot be overstated. You kind of withdraw into your own worlds, and you're managing only what you can manage. Tony and I have literally bore each other's burdens our whole marriage, but this was different. And I couldn't take on his grief. He had all he could manage, and he wasn't managing it well. And it really turned into some problems for our marriage. And we sought marriage counseling.
Mm-hmm. 'Cause there were some things I couldn't help you with. I couldn't fix or understand how to help you. Mm-hmm. 'Cause especially the first couple years, sometimes it's just moment by moment you're being able to move forward.
Right. And there's no shame in acknowledging that, as a husband and wife, you definitely have different grieving styles. And sometimes we expect our spouse, especially as a female and even as a male, we expect our spouse to read between the lines and know what we need. But that, friend, is only going to set you up for even more, let's say, discord.
Difficulties.
Right? Because we're so in our own heads. We're so in our own grief, we can barely function, much less be able to perceive what our spouse needs. So I will say that the marriage counseling that we did, mm-hmm. and I was pretty insistent that Tony seek help, and he did, thankfully. He agreed with me that he did need help. And so that two factors, I think the fact that you sought personal help and we sought marriage counseling. Now, here we are 6 years later, and our marriage is stronger because of it. But if you are in the throes of early grief, it's very, very normal for a couple to live in the same household and grieve very differently. And that communication barrier is definitely significant. And one of the things you can do, I'll just give you a quick tip about that, is that if you're not able to verbalize what you need to your spouse, write it down. Write it in a letter. I remember coaching someone along these lines. They had had a stillborn baby, and her and her partner were just at completely different places in their grief. And it was difficult for them to communicate because he would talk over her or not be able to acknowledge as she was talking. It was a lot of reaction. So, and that's typical in a marriage, a husband or a partner or a husband and wife. You know, if you say something, it tends to come out accusatory. Well, then they're going to react to that, and then you end up in an argument and you both feel like a failure. So often it's a good tool. First of all, I recommend counseling where you can sit under the wise counsel of a Christian counselor, mm-hmm. marriage counselor, or grief counselor. But in the meantime, write down how you feel and then give that to your spouse to allow them to read it in their own personal time where they read it, but you're not there for them to react to. And so it can open up their eyes to a different view that they've not had before. So that's just one small little tip there regarding marriage. One last question before we finish up. What is your biggest challenge, Tony, going forward? I mean, we're 6 years into our grief, but we've got many, many years ahead of us before we're reunited with our son.
Well, the biggest challenge is just not being able to do life with Andrew anymore here on earth. It's going to seem like a long time, but really it's not going to be, because the one thing I always share is my timeline's getting shorter each year that passes, so I'm that much closer to seeing him. But just being able to just do things with him, the milestones that you would have doing life with your family, doing vacations, holidays. I retired a year ago this month. I was looking forward to when I retired, having more time to hang out and do things with Andrew. It's just those kind of things that I won't get to do here on earth, but I know in heaven I'll get to spend eternity with him, and just looking forward to that day. It's just something I have to work at every day, knowing that that day's coming.
Well, and as you know, the point that you're making, and it's a good point, that it is a journey. And what we have to do as grieving parents is to constantly come back to the truth. The overwhelming despair that we can feel when we start thinking about all the things that Tony listed, all these things that he's not going to be able to do with Andrew. And it's okay to do that, and it's actually healthy to acknowledge those things, but it's not healthy to dwell on that to the place where it takes you down into that pit of despair. Because, and the way you prevent that from happening is that you constantly bring it back to the truth. You know, the visualization that you were talking about that Paul helped you with EMDR. Mm-hmm. We know that Andrew is safe and secure in the everlasting arms of our Father.
He's in a much better place.
And that doesn't necessarily feel good in the beginning, especially if you're in early grief, but it will be a comfort as you start to process your grief and get those tools that you need to work through those hard places. When you get those big valleys managed well, then you'll have all these tools in your toolbox, and then you'll be able to pull one of those out. And that's what you do when you start looking at what I call the long haul of the rest of our life. First of all, you guys know that I teach you, tomorrow has enough worries of his own. We live the day we're given, because nobody knows better than you and us that life can change in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye. So we can spend all of our wills and all of our energy thinking about what's going to happen in 10 years or 15 years, and we may not even be here. So the goal is to live exactly how our Heavenly Father has taught us to live, and that is one day at a time. And we're told over and over in scriptures that there's new mercies every morning because we need them. We are not limitless human beings. We cannot face the rest of our life, the day we're living, and be able to survive it. That is not how God created us to be. We live in the moments that we have right now. What tomorrow brings, but we live today. It's very difficult. The reality is, yes, we have several years that we are going to be here on earth. Maybe. We don't know, you know, when our days are numbered. We don't know when God's going to call us home. But the reality of it is, we are doing life without Andrew. However, we need to constantly remind ourselves that God has given us the ability, with him walking beside us, to manage this journey. He's put people in your life like me. God has called me to do exactly what I'm doing, to help you see on the other side. When I very first started on this journey and I wrote that devotion book, I wrote a devotion called On the Other Side of the Trust. Because, and that story is based on Ruth and Naomi, because they lost everything. Okay, everything. And they went back to their hometown. If you guys remember that story, when they got back to Bethlehem, Naomi's friends ran to meet her. They were so excited to see her. And they started calling her name, Naomi, Naomi. And she said, don't call me Naomi. Call me Mara, for the Lord has made life bitter for me. That was such a confirmation that I was not alone in my grief, that it was okay to feel the way that I felt in those moments. But God took that story and turned it into a but God story. And the offspring of that relationship between Ruth and Boaz was in the line of David, which is in the line of Christ. So we never know what God is going to do with our story. But the point here is we cannot focus on tomorrow. We must live the day that we are living. Your journey is difficult. But as you heard today, surviving the death of your child is a journey. It doesn't end, but it does change. I pray that you were encouraged by our chat today and that you see glimmers of hope for your journey. Maybe you were able to take some ideas away from our story and create an ideal for yourself in honoring your child. Tony and I have always been very real with you in sharing our grief. We're just not ones to create a fake happy smile while we're dying on the inside. That is not real life, and I would never sugarcoat the death of our child to someone who is going through that themselves, because that is not who we are. That is not who I am. But I always want to share our journey of hope with you. We are never meant to walk this journey alone. That's why I've been pouring into you for nearly 3 years. February 2025 will be the 3-year anniversary of the Grief Mentor Podcast. 3 years of pouring my heart and soul into the lives that have been devastated by the death of your child. I'm not sure what I will do to celebrate that anniversary of the podcast, but I will do something special that day. February 14th is the day that I started the podcast out of my great love for my son, Andrew, out of the love for my Heavenly Father who asked me, and I said yes, and my love for you, the one he sent me to. Friend, I don't have all the answers, but I know the one who does. Come join me in a grief mentor session. You'll be so glad that you did. I can't wait to help you see what God has for you. But I can't do it without your yes. I want to leave you with God's word today, for I know the plans I have for you. So this is a common verse that we hear in Jeremiah 29:11. We hear it all the time as a verse of hope, and it is a verse of hope. However, it can be taken out of context. So let's make sure we understand it correctly today. God gave this verse to the Israelites while they were still in captivity. Okay? They were still in Babylon. They had been there for a long time, and the journey wasn't over. They were discouraged because they had not been delivered yet, and they, in their minds, thought that this was going to be over long before it was. But God's response to them was, "We're not done yet. You still have more time being in captivity for your future." He reminded them, "But don't forget." And he gave them this verse, "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you, not to harm you. Plans to give you a hope and a future." Jeremiah 29:11. Here's the meat of that verse, friend. Growth happens in the valley. In the valley is where we develop perseverance. In the valley is where we learn He is our everything. It's where we learn to trust Him in spite of the pain that you're living in. His presence is the key to survival. Your future depends on it. And that's all I have for you today. So until next time, take care. Did today's episode touch your heart? I pray that it did. Did you walk away a little lighter? If you did, would you share this episode with someone that you know needs to hear it today? And could you take 30 seconds to leave me a review on Apple Podcast? I would so appreciate it if you did. From my heart to yours, see you next week.